It is now my pleasure to introduce to you the President of the NYSCOSS Executive Committee for the 22-23 school year, my friend, my colleague, Martha Group.
And thank you. Good afternoon. I'm honored to be here with such incredible leaders, leaders who continue to give so much. Emerson reminded us, life is a journey, not a destination. A journey filled with challenges, opportunities, and celebrations. It's the human experience, one that upon reflection brings us purpose and meaning. Think back to March of 2020. Where were you? What were you doing that first week? I have a vivid memory of Tuesday, March 3rd, 2020. I was in Albany in the Capital Center for the NYSCOSS Winter Institute when Chuck approached me to join a group of superintendents for a meeting with Acting Commissioner Tahoe to discuss the response to the rapidly evolving pandemic. The night before, then-Governor Cuomo had sent the legislature an emergency supplemental appropriation of $40 million to fight the coronavirus outbreak, which gave the governor expansive powers for a full year and the ability to institute mass quarantines. Spectrum News noted in a press release that some here believe coronavirus has the potential to overshadow everything, pushing all other issues to the side. How prophetic. In the days that followed, Governor Cuomo declared a state of emergency and signed an executive order directing all schools to close for 2 weeks. As we know, schools remained closed for the rest of the school year. Suddenly, we were thrust into the unknown, the unfamiliar, and the word unprecedented came into wide use. During COVID, I happened to read The Great Influenza, the story of the deadliest pandemic in history by John Barry. The parallels between Barry's book, published in 2004, 15 years before COVID-19 emerged onto the world stage, and the COVID-19 pandemic are striking. I thought to myself, how is it that we, as ordinary people, know so little about the lived experience of people during the Great Influenza, a mere 100 years earlier? It's not as though we hadn't heard of it. Then, this past January, I happened to catch a segment of 60 Minutes about StoryCorps' latest project. NPR listeners will be familiar with the StoryCorps mission, to preserve and share humanity's stories in order to build connections between people and create a more just and compassionate world. To remind one another of our shared humanity, to strengthen and build connections between people, to teach the value of listening, and to weave into the fabric of our culture the understanding that everyone's story matters, and at the same time, creating an invaluable archive for future generations. I thought, what if we had had the gift of hearing the stories of people like us who experienced a similar pandemic? Would it have made it less painful, less deadly, less challenging? No, but perhaps we would have felt less alone. Perhaps we would have been less polarized. Perhaps we wouldn't have repeated some of the same mistakes of the past, and perhaps we would not have felt so helpless. These experiences formed the genesis of the VBS story, a portion of which you viewed a short time ago. You will recall that it is a story of care, compassion, and community, a story of facing the challenges of today and rising toward our future together. All your districts have a similar story. Buckminster Fuller said, "We are called to be architects of the future, not its victims." I think it's significant that Fuller uses the word we rather than I. As we emerge from the challenges of the past 2 years, we are called to be architects of the future for our public schools. The council is composed of leaders, educators, and advocates. Each of us here is connected to each other in service to the education of our children in our public schools. As we reflect on the journey of the past 2 years and all its challenges, and celebrate the opportunity to be together, we must work in concert with each other and our communities to focus on our purpose and create public schools that prepare every child for the world as it exists today and as it will exist in the future. We are public servants. Robert Greenleaf coined the phrase servant leadership, stating, "The servant leader is a servant first. Servant leadership manifests itself in making the needs of those being served the highest priority. The best test, and difficult to administer, is do those served grow as persons? Do they, while being served, become healthier, wiser, freer, more autonomous, more likely themselves to become servants? And what is the effect on the least privileged in society? Will they benefit, or at least not be further deprived?" A servant leader focuses primarily on the growth and well-being of people and the communities to which they belong. The servant leader shares power, puts the needs of others first, and helps people to develop and perform as highly as possible. We've all heard the wisdom of American cultural anthropologist Margaret Mead, who said, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has." Mead meant that every cultural change, no matter how widespread, must begin with a few individuals. When it comes to public education in New York, we must be those few individuals, those who have chosen to serve our public schools and every child who enters our doors every day. Real change cannot be achieved by a single individual. It will require us to work together. Real change is hard, it takes place over time, and it's tedious. It will require us to persevere despite roadblocks, challenges, disappointments, and the delays we will encounter. Real change in public education is something we must commit to. Our children need it. Together, we are rising to shape education for today, tomorrow, and beyond. This summit, beginning with our keynote address with Dana Mortensen, provides us with tools to take back to the regions and schools across New York State, where we will continue the work necessary to create public schools where every child succeeds every day, now and into the future. Thank you for serving our children and our communities, and I look forward to our time together over the next few days and beyond.